Five in 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Now live.
89.5 WSKB.
From the campus of Westfield State University, this is 89.5 FM, WSKB, Westfield.
Support for the community programming of WSKB is provided by the Dunkin' Donut Shops of Westfield and the Sardinia family. It's nice to know that even as the world changes, Dunkin' Coffee remains the same at 7 convenient locations throughout Westfield.
Good morning, Westfield. It is 6:01. You're listening to WSKB 89.5 FM radio for the Westfield masses and WCPC cable channel 15. My name is Tina Gorman. I'm your Wake Up Wednesday host, and I am in the studio this morning with the chairman of the board, Pete Coles. Good morning, Pete.
Good morning.
All right, so let's talk about this trip to Alabama. How did all of that go? How did that shake off there, buddy? You're back, and we're happy you're back.
Yeah, I made it down there about 7 o'clock in the morning on Monday.
Okay.
Worked all day with the guys, and then went and crashed. Took a shower and crashed. And then
this was a week ago, Monday,
yeah.
Right? Yeah, a week ago,
all day
Monday.
Tuesday, I was on the ground. We got as much done as we could, and then Wednesday morning, I drove back and got home around 3 o'clock in the morning, and then was here at 5 on Thursday, 5:30.
Oh my God! So you went down to Alabama for what purpose? Just for our
to
viewers, some of them don't know
up.
What you're involved with.
So every year, I volunteer with Babe Ruth International for the Babe Ruth World Series. I've done it since 2017. And we moved to a new location, a beautiful complex in northern Alabama.
You had been in Florida, right?
Right, yeah. We had been in Florida. Yeah. And the problem is when you're in one place too long, the volunteer base kind of burns out.
Got it.
It just, yeah. unless there's a really good organizational structure there, it's organic. It just burns out.
Yeah, yep,
So this complex has hosted a lot of tournaments. They host games for the University of North Alabama softball team.
Mm-hmm.
So they have a lot of they're used to big events.
Yeah, they have stuff in place for this.
Right. Yeah. And they have, you know, some full-time staff and a good volunteer base. So we moved up there, and they had never done cameras in every field before, so they weren't set up for that.
And how many fields are we talking about here, Pete?
In the complex right now, they have seven. Right now they have 13. They're going to 17 shortly.
Wow. Okay.
Or 18.
Okay.
So we're doing the softball fields. We got 4 done. Got the network established. Got all those kinks worked out that you normally have to do when you're putting your network into another network type of thing.
Yeah.
And that's the problem. That's the reason I impressed that upon Babe Ruth was they wanted to try to do it 3 days before the teams arrived.
Yeah.
And I said no.
Yeah.
Flat up no.
Yeah.
Originally, I was going to fly down there. They never gave me permission to use the credit card to buy the flight, so I drove.
Yeah.
I told him I was going no matter what. It had to get done.
Yeah.
The IT director down there agreed with me. He says, this would be crazy trying to do this a couple days beforehand. And it was good because we ran into problems where it took us a whole day to figure out the networking issue.
Yeah.
And, you know, the pressure would have been unbearable with teams coming.
Yeah, you know, you and I are just not people that fly by the seat of our pants. If we can avoid it. I mean, sometimes you can't avoid it.
Right.
This was avoidable. I mean, you know,
right.
Go down early, get it done, work out the bugs. And
right. And now, well, now their guys are comfortable with it.
Yep.
And you know, they're going to put up the rest of the cameras. The parks guys are comfortable with it. They now have a way to look at the fields, which they never had before.
Yeah, which is nice.
They have security cameras, but none of the cameras are pointed at a field. They're pointed at common walkways.
Yeah.
They're pointed at parking areas, which is what they should be.
Sure.
But the park and rec, the guy that's the superintendent of the park is like, I now can look from my desk if it rains and tell you how long we're going to be delayed.
Because
I know how my fields drain.
That must be fabulous for him.
Right. He's wicked psyched about it.
Yeah, I'm sure.
Absolutely. And his guys are like, this is awesome.
Yeah.
You know, we don't have to physically get onto the field anymore. We can look at it from a good vantage point and see how the fields are draining and things like that.
Yep.
So it's a win-win all the way around.
All is well.
It's just a lot of driving.
That was a lot of driving in a short period of time.
Right.
Did you do the back? Did you stop overnight anywhere?
No.
Pete.
I took naps.
Yeah.
It's a lot of driving.
It is a lot of driving.
Yeah. I wouldn't mind doing it as a 2-day drive.
Yeah. Well, that's a little bit different. And when you have somebody else in the car, what do you do for all those hours? Like, that's a lot of
listening to podcasts.
Yeah.
Taking a lot of breaks.
Yeah. Okay. Good.
You know, you could take a 10-minute break just to stretch,
yes.
Go to the bathroom,
yes.
You know, get gas,
yes.
Whatever.
Yep.
And that does help.
Yes. Yeah. Absolutely.
And then a 30-minute power nap does help, too.
Yep. And now when does the series actually begin? July, right?
I fly out the 20th, and I think the teams arrive on the 23rd.
Okay. Of July.
Yep.
And then
I'm back August 4th.
Yep. So that's a like a week and change, 2 weeks. You used to go down for like 3 weeks.
Right, because I would do Babe Ruth, I would do softball and Cal Ripken.
Yeah.
This year I'm only doing softball.
Gotcha.
And then I'm coming back.
Okay. All right.
Yeah. I mean, there's a lot of work. They have a lot of great volunteers down there.
Yeah.
I'm psyched because the area that I'm working in, the scoring tower.
Yep.
They built this place out pretty well.
Nice.
In the area that I'm working, if you're a scorer, you have windows on every field, but there's also a bathroom on the second floor.
Yay.
So you don't have to run downstairs every time you got to go.
Yep. Nice.
Which is outstanding. And then there's a cooler with water right up on the floor you're at because you're up on a second floor. So
yeah. Nice.
Running down, waiting for the bathroom, trying to run back. That doesn't work.
Pete, how are the accommodations there for you? Will you have a good place to stay? Is it okay?
I stayed in a different hotel than where I'm staying for the series.
Okay.
But Florence is a pretty good sized city. I mean, got all the, it's not some little sleepy town. It's a pretty good sized town because it's a college town.
Right. And it's got to be decent. I mean, you're bringing all these families and players. I mean, a lot of people coming in at one time.
Right. I mean, it's not necessarily set up like a vacation area, more like Jensen Beach was.
Yep.
But there's still enough hotel rooms in the area and things like that.
Good.
So.
Perfect.
Yeah.
Good. So all is well down in Alabama. Everything's set up and ready to go.
Well, for the most, they still got a couple more fields.
As far as you could do.
Right. There's got a couple more fields. I got to get on the guys about that. And then they're still under construction, completely AstroTurf fields.
Okay.
So they hope to play the Cal Ripken on that. And those aren't even done yet.
Okay.
They're hoping to get them done.
And so it goes.
Right. But the guys, now we have a pretty good idea of how to do that and how to set it up. Things like that. And we think the networking issue will lend itself to how they have the new fields set up and ready to go.
Perfect.
So, they'll just be end up pulling more cameras and that type of thing. So
good.
Cross your fingers.
All right. Fingers crossed. All is well. And I'm glad you're back safely, Pete. I was a little, I knew it was, I mean, I was a little nervous about you going down there by yourself. And, you know, I mean, just, it's just a long way to go. Yeah.
Because when I fly, I fly to Nashville, and then it's only like a 2-hour drive from Nashville.
Yeah.
It's not a big deal.
Yeah.
2 hours, no big deal.
Yeah. No, that's, how long did, how many hours was it to get down there?
I mean, it was like 19.
Yeah. Yeah. It's a long way.
Yeah, it is a long way.
All right. So I have to talk about our Father's Day concert that we had on Friday night, which was probably one of the best concerts we've ever done at the Senior Center.
No kidding.
You know, I'm going to tell you that I think the 100 people that were there would absolutely agree with me. It was a little dicey because the heavens opened up about an hour and change before we were going to, before the concert. The concert started at 6:15. This was doo-wop meets Motown. So
was
we
it
had,
outside or inside?
No, it was inside.
Oh, okay.
It was inside. But, I mean, it was such a torrential downpour. And Leslie Anderson, who was my doo-wop guy, lives in Springfield. And Leslie said he got halfway here and he just thought, what am I doing? I mean, this is insane. He had to pull over. You couldn't see 2 feet in front of you.
Right.
So it was pretty wild and crazy. But I was betting on the fact that that came in early enough that by the time we got closer to when, you know, the concert was actually going to start, that things would have settled down, which they did. And honestly, by the time I think it started at 6:15, I think the sun was already coming out. But, you know, they're seniors. They like to get there really early. Mm-hmm. So we did have some people that, you know, kind of drove through and then they just sat in their cars until the rain let up enough for them, you know, to come in. But we had a great crowd. This was our Father's Day. This was our tribute to fathers and godfathers and grandfathers and father figures.
Yep.
So Leslie Anderson was our doo-wop person, and Irv Lewis, who is no stranger to the Senior Center stage, was our Motown guy. And you know what, Pete? It was so much fun. I mean, right out of the gate, these guys were just, you know, the performers were just so excited to be there. And I think, I don't think they got to the second song and we already had people up dancing in the corner. And we didn't, you know, sometimes we'll create almost like a little dance stage in the middle of the room. And I didn't really do that this time.
Yeah.
But because there was plenty of room on the outside, and man, we had people up and dancing for almost the whole thing. We had one woman, and Kathy, first of all, I want a huge shout out to my volunteers because I was the only staff member there. Which is a little intimidating only because, you know, I always think like if we have to call 911, you know, it would be nice to have another staff person, but yeah, everybody was tied up. But I had phenomenal, I had my A team on volunteers. So I had Barbara Martone and Kathy Millis, who are my two volunteers extraordinaire. And then Jim Liptak, who is chair of the COA board, and his wife, Angela DeRowan, were also helping me out that night. And so, you know, with the five of us, it was fantastic. Mm-hmm. Fran St. Peter and Bruce Marshall came. They weren't kind of scheduled in, yep. but they came in about maybe a quarter of the way through the concert. Bruce, of course, you know.
Bruce, that's right up his alley.
Right, it's right up his alley. I think he wanted to, you know, check this out. And so it was so great. But anyway, about three quarters of the way through the concert, Kathy Millis pulls me aside and she says to me, "Who is that lady over there wearing yellow?" We had a senior who came in. She got there just a little bit late and she told Barbara Martone that she had also purchased a ticket for her caregiver, but her caregiver couldn't come, you know, ended up having to back out. I don't know whether it was weather related or whatever.
Yep.
But the woman was there. We don't know how she got there, if somebody else dropped her off or whatever. We didn't recognize her, came in. Kathy said, "Tina, she knows the words to every single song that Leslie and Irv were singing and playing." So really unbelievable. But so fun. And there was so much singing and mouthing of the words. And, you know, for me, every song that they started to sing, I was jumping up and down saying, "I love that song. I love that song." Or, "Oh, that's my favorite song." So it was a fabulous, fabulous, fabulous concert. And again,
that's awesome.
Yeah. You know, it was just one of those. It was so good that they were supposed to perform for an hour.
Yep.
And Irv looked at the clock at like 20 after 7 and he said, "That can't be right. Like, we couldn't have already been playing for an hour." And everybody felt the same way. And Irv just shouted out and he goes, "Do you want us to stay for a while and keep playing?" And, you know, of course, we're all like, "Yes, we want you to keep playing."
Sure,
so
yeah.
They did. So they played for like another 15 or 20 minutes. And then on the way out, as we traditionally do for our dads, everybody got a really nice, large ice cream sundae to take home with them on the way out.
Nice.
You know, it has just become this tradition, which started years ago when we first moved into the new senior center with Corey and the Knightsmen. And that's when, Corey DeGray was still alive.
Yep.
And he had come to us and said, you know, they wanted to perform. And Mary Lou and I were sort of trying to figure out, how do we want to do this? And we really didn't want to do it as like, and he really couldn't do it as like a morning or a daytime thing. So we settled on an early evening concert, and we came up with this concept. We would do it for Father's Day. It worked out with their schedule. And then we decided, well, what did dads want? Well, you know, they wanted ice cream to go home. And so that became this tradition. And I think this is, well, we've been in the senior center. We're in our ninth year now. So I think we've done this for 7 or 8 out of the 9 years, of course, minus COVID. You know, we had that whole scene, but just such a great time. It was awesome. I thank Leslie Anderson and Irv Lewis. Oh, and then Irv came up with this great idea that the next time we do this, what he wants to do is, because nobody wanted to go home, including them, including the performers.
Right.
So his thought was that we all just like take a break, and then he and Irv will perform until, you know, like 3 a.m. And then we'll get Joanne and George to come back and make breakfast for everyone. So that was the, and we can change into our pajamas. So that was his thing.
Oh, cool.
But I said to him, you know, we actually did have a pajama party at the senior center, which he thought was the coolest thing ever. I said, yes, right before COVID, we had, we made our wacky tacky day, wacky tacky pajama day, and we did it that way.
Cool.
All right. So enough about your trip. We have a really fabulous,
in.
I know they are. I can see the cars. We have a fabulous show this morning. This is our 10-year anniversary edition. We have been on the air We are completing our 10th year. My mystery guests have arrived, so I'm going to bring them in. And while we bring them in, we are going to listen to Bruce Springsteen singing Glory Days, because these have been glory days. You're listening to WSKB 89.5 FM radio for the Westfield masses and WCPC cable channel 15. We'll be back in just a few.
Underwriting support for the community programming of WSKB is provided by the Greater Westfield Chamber of Commerce, the voice of business for the Greater Westfield communities. Informing, educating, advocating, the Chamber provides opportunities for members to make meaningful connections on local, regional, and state levels. For more information on the Chamber's many events, workshops, and programs, as well as the benefits of membership, visit westfieldbiz.org. The Chamber focuses on the most important economy, yours.
Hi, it's Bob Plass, and I have Wow, It's Tuesday, every Tuesday, 6 to 8. Wow, It's Tuesday.
Community Radio.
89.5 WSKB.
I did it.
Live from Studio 120 at Westfield Technical Academy, this is WCPC Channel 15 and 89.5 FM WSKB Westfield.
Good morning, Westfield. It is 6:20. You're listening to WSKB 89.5 FM, radio for the Westfield masses, and WCPC, cable channel 15. My name is Tina Gorman. I'm your Wake Up Wednesday host, and we have the A-team here. This is
You're letting the hooligans in.
This is the special 10-year anniversary edition of Wake Up Wednesday. We have Pete Coles, chairman of the board, behind the board. Pete has been with us for the whole 10 years.
It wasn't supposed to be, Dan. Just we need you for the summer. Yeah.
Well, it was. And we're going to stroll down memory lane. We're going to talk about the history of how all of this got started. And with me to do that this morning, I have the Knapik brothers. We have Dan Knapik, former mayor of Westfield and former Wake Up Wednesday host. Yep. I was simply just a little sidekick. I was like the Ed McMahon when we started. And Mike Knapik, former Senator Knapik. And Mike is former Senator Knapik and former management. If you recall, the emails would come from management.
I have a sound effect for him. At least according to Patrick, the evil genius.
So we are celebrating 10 years on the air. It started in the summer of 2014, and it was the beginning of June. Dan and I did the first show together. You'll appreciate this, Dan. So 2 weeks ago, I now have Carol Palmer on my show once a month. Mm-hmm. So she's kind of our fitness, you know, guru person that we have on. And Carol and I started a series at the beginning of the summer on outdoor activities, and especially outdoor activities for people who maybe have never done it before. So we had Ted Perez in here. We talked about golf. So 2 weeks ago, we had Harry Rock in to talk about cycling. And, you know, if you've never cycled before, you know, there's a lot to it. And so anyway, Harry now, of course, has his own show. He's had his own monthly show, Rock on Westfield. So
he's like 7 years, I think.
Yeah. So, but what's really funny, though, is that if you recall, Dan, like the first couple of weeks that we did this, Dan and I would get there at like, you know, 5:45. We were up at the college. We'd have our headphones on. We'd have all our stuff. We're very prepared. Everybody's up. Anna Duncan. Everybody's really good to go. 2 weeks ago, Carol, Harry, and I, like the music's going. We're already on air. We're all putting on our headphones. You know, we're just like throwing things around. You know, it's that last minute. You kind of get comfortable with it after a while. But, you know, that first week was a little hairy. All right. So we're going to talk about how all this got started because, you know, a lot of people have tuned in over the years, but they weren't there for the original. And the original, we were not on television. We were not on Channel 15. It was strictly radio. Yeah. And we were not broadcasting from Westfield Technical Academy. We were broadcasting from Westfield State University. So I'm going to start with former management here, the Mike of the Knapik brothers, because how did all of this start? And I think you were here at the beginning to kind of push this along there, my friend.
Well, happy anniversary. Happy 10 years.
I know, right?
For our listeners, our hosts, and everybody. As I think back, and I was, you know, it was a long time ago as we think about it. You know, it's all about opportunity. And I think, you know, when you talk and think back about town gown partnerships, Westfield State, City of Westfield, I think it really emanated from that. You know, for decades, Westfield State had a radio club as part of the communications, not really the communications department, but an adjunct student organization with a small antenna up on the Ely Campus Center, which is in the back of the campus. And there were discussions, I think, coming out of the late 2000s about an opportunity to build a new antenna with a greater broadcasting field to it. And so when I came to Westfield State in 2013, those conversations with the city were ongoing. And a lot of us remember, we hearkened back and we talked about this at the time, that, you know, all these smaller communities used to have their own radio stations back in the day.
Yep.
We grew up with the radio stations. And here in Westfield, it was the former WDEW, the Dew Line, which then became WLDM, owned by the Hans. Seal and Kurt Hahn.
Right.
So that was our local Westfield radio station. You could call in, you had hosts.
And where was that? Like, where was
On Union Street.
Okay.
But the tower's still there.
Yeah.
The
tower is still
there. The original tower is still there.
Yeah. So that was what we grew up on in the 60s, 70s. Holyoke had radio stations. Springfield had a number of them. And, you know, obviously the big blowtorch, WTIC out of Hartford, Bob Steele. We talked about all of that back a decade or so ago, that could you bring some flavor back to a community radio, respecting, though, that this was a student resource at Westfield State, in that we would have to do it, Peter, you recall those conversations, in concert with the club, and would they even appreciate the community partners coming in with a whole different kind of vibe to programming. And so that's how it began. And, you know, Dan, I'll turn it to you to talk about, you know, how we didn't become a 50,000-watt or 500,000-watt radio station. But, you know, even as I was driving to Springfield yesterday, you were still coming loud and clear on the road to Springfield. And that led and paved the way toward some underwriting support, because this was not, you know, obviously we had to figure out a way to make it sustainable, to provide some resources, and we ultimately provide a scholarship, or they do provide a scholarship to the students of Westfield State. But that was also part of the vision, not only to get the characters of Westfield involved, present company on either side.
There you go.
But also because, you know, not commercial radio, because we're a not-for-profit, you're a not-for-profit.
Right.
So there's strict guidelines around that. And then we brought in some expertise we can talk about. But
and, Mike, what was your role in at Westfield State University at the time?
So I was the I was recruited in to be the executive director of the Westfield State Foundation, which managed the fundraising, the scholarship portfolio, events, and such at Westfield State to help raise resources. And so we viewed this, or I certainly viewed it, as an opportunity to bring in some monies to the college, bring in greater community participation, because even from I just saw you had the Westfield Chamber of Commerce as one of the underwriters. They were not there a decade ago, but obviously what this provides, both now through the visual medium, is an opportunity for local individuals to obviously advertise in, in a way that they had not been able to before. I think you've got probably a very loyal following. Pete, I don't know if you still track you know, the hits that sometimes occur on some of the ratings, but I know early on and through the mid part of this decade of engagement, there was a lot of people listening to this.
We don't get the website stats, and the Comcast won't really give us. I know they can get the hits on the boxes and stuff, but people seem to know what we're talking about still. That's my benchmark, is if they're engaged enough to tell you, hey, I heard you talking about this the other day, or I can't believe you guys did that, you know, or something like that, you know. It's been that, that's been the harbinger of it right along, is that people know what we're talking about, even though they say they never listen to us.
No. Well, what really cracks me up is when, you know, like I'll be at Big Y or Stop and Shop and somebody will come up to me and say, oh, I saw you on TV. And, you know, they'll launch into whatever we talked about. And I'll kind of look at them and say, you do know that's like not my real job, right? I mean, you know, it's like, oh, man, you know, this is so cool. And it's like, yeah, that's. That's, well, now it's part of my job. It's actually been written into the job description after all these years. So
I don't know. I think it's been part of your job for a while. I don't know.
Well, it was, but not that the city was, you know, paying me for it or
that's
anything.
True,
but
yeah.
You know, those extra hours. But yeah. But now it actually is part of the job description, which is kind of fun. So you reached out to your brother, who was then mayor of Westfield, with this kind of concept idea, right?
Well, I think we were immersed in conversations with this antenna. So, Dan, are you
okay?
Yeah, so, you know, interestingly enough, good morning, everyone, and it's great to be back, and I'm glad Tina invited us in. You know, not every you know, opportunity do we jump at, but this is certainly one we do, right?
Even at this hour. I was so excited that I know. I'm thinking, oh, my God, they are so not going to want to be here at 6:15.
So true to our origins, I have my Duncan cup.
Yep, there you
Thank
go.
Thank you to the Sardina family. And I have my Westfield State
t-shirt
on.
Yep.
That was the birthplace. But, you know, so at the city level, there was a lot of, at that time, and you gotta remember, like, what the world was like back
then. Yeah, and that's what I want you to do, like set the stage for us, Dan.
Yeah, so Patrick Berry had recently bought the newspaper, and one of the things that was occurring, we were engaging Comcast on a new negotiation for a cable contract, and at that same time, streaming opportunities became, you know, just talked about at that time. And so the other big issue in the room back then was we had an agreement. Public and educational government access channel had been moved up to Westfield State. And again, it's the important part was the players at the time.
Yeah.
It was the right people at the right time. And you had Dr. Dobell up there at the time, who really, I think, really supersized that town-gown relationship. prior to my arrival in office, there was a lot of things going on, the synergy. We were opening up the dormitory downtown.
I remember.
I was there, right? So at that point, the collaboration on a lot of fronts, there was that new non-for-profit board that would meet on a regular basis across the city. The college would host it and whatnot. But the key for us was, what do we get? We always wanted to do more with public programming. And one of the things when we moved up to Westfield State with Mark St. Jean, who was a critical component of this, is to take advantage of the campus up there and the communications infrastructure that they have to do, citizen-generated content for TV. And for a lot of different reasons, looking back now, that didn't ever happen because the campus was so kind of detached to that point. We had visions like it used to be when you had a campus at East Mountain Road with Comcast, that people would step forward, they'd do their own programming, things of this nature, you know. And the thing on our mind was, the decline of local news was just starting to happen. And this opportunity presented itself as part of the renewal of the PEG contract, the Comcast issue. And I don't remember the wattage that the new antenna is. Is it 100 watts?
No, that wasn't the problem. The original antenna was a home-built, we found out.
Okay, right.
And we took it down, and it wasn't polarized properly. So it was only shooting, I think it was only horizontal. And most antennas on cars are vertical. So you're only picking up a little slice of it. And it was barely getting off campus.
Yeah, that's correct.
It was
right?
the same power, but it was barely getting off campus. So when we replaced it with a proper antenna, now you got into Springfield, you got the full contour of what the power would put out.
In those early days, we would get people on the turnpike calling us in, like as far as Ludlow and up, west Otis, towards Otis area, and then down south. I remember getting it sometimes south of Hartford, So we were just, at that time it was exciting. But, going back, it was the right players at the right time. We Mike made this overture, hey, what do you think we could do here? And I remember at the time the players, of course, Brent Bean was part of that as his role at the college and also with the city. Bo Sullivan was at the table at the time because we also knew there needed to be a money component. And we never lost sight of the fact that this was a student-generated station, and we wanted to be sensitive to that. But there was this great opportunity to try to do something and bring it back. And certainly people in our age demographic, I think more so than the younger generations, there was a certain nostalgia opportunity if we were successful here that we could promote local activities, kind of like go back to the old days of WDEW, WLDM. We talked about, sports programming and things of this nature. And that started a series of conversations that essentially led to the opening broadcast, which was Shoestring at the time. I mean, Jake Lehan was the first producer, right?
Yes, he was. Jake.
And we just literally walked into that studio, that radio studio. It was like a little bit like WKRP, I think, in there. And we just rolled it, and it went. And it became, looking back now, phenomenally successful for what we pulled off.
Yeah. You know, what was funny, what I remember about that first morning, and I kind of was, this is how it came to be that I was a participant in all of this, was Dan had a department head meeting, and he said to me as people were coming in, other department heads, and he said, Tina, at the end, he goes, when the meeting's over, stick around. I want to talk to you about something. That was how that. I want to float an idea by you. So I said, okay, thinking, all right. And I'm thinking it's going to have something to do with the seniors and, all of that. And so anyway, talked to the guy, and he said, we're going to do this radio thing, and, I want you to jump in with me, and I think this is going to be great. We're going to do this together. And so I, I used to do community theater. I thought, hey, this ought to be fun. I've never done radio, but okay. So I remember asking him, like, the week before, I said, what am I supposed to do? I mean, do I do anything? Do I have any prep work or anything? And Mr. Fly by the seat of his pants over there says to me, well, get some statistics or something. So I get on the phone with the executive office of Elder Affairs. I call my friend Emmett Schmarzo over there. I'm like, Emmett, I need stats. He goes, okay, well, what are you looking for? I said, I have no idea. Just give me some stats. Anything that has to do with seniors in Massachusetts, And, you know, I'll be able to do something with that. And you know, over the weeks, it just kind of morphed into, you know, sort of a lot of what I still do now. You know, we do announcements about community programming. And what was fun was that it was in the summer. We had the Stanley Park series. At the time, we had the Amelia Park concerts. We had, you know, children's. There was stuff going on downtown. We had the summer concert series that WOW was doing. If you recall that, they did like three or four concerts this summer.
That's right, yeah.
So there was a lot of, you know, there were a lot of things to start talking about. WOW was, you know, really up and running. And, you know, so there was, you know, so we did this whole section on community announcements. And then you brought in, you know, Kenny, the Facebook guy. But I do remember we were not very far into this when Jake, our producer, kind of said, oh, I just landed my dream job and I can't do this anymore. Yeah. And that was like, what, Dan? Maybe not even a month
into it. No, that was very quickly. I mean, it was like two weeks in. Yeah. What are we going to do now?
And so how did you find Pete? How did Pete get in here? How did that connection happen?
So let me just go back to that meeting just for a real second. So,
oh, yeah, go ahead.
You know, one of the things that makes a good leader a much better leader is to know the talent that the leader has, okay? So when confronted with this opportunity, I'm like, man, I'm going to have to blabber on for a couple hours early in the morning. I'm like, who in the team could do that with me, right? So, you know, one of the things I always appreciated about Tina was meticulous preparation, no matter what it was, whether it was preparing lunch at the senior center, you know, whatever it was, you know. And I'm like, well, Tina would be like a natural. We get along great. We're doing the senior center thing, you know, and there's a lot to talk about. But the other key part of that was who would be our natural audience, right? Mm-hmm. And it was going to be the folks that you interacted with.
Yes.
You know? So I'm like, this is going to be great. So like a lot of the hosts that we, you know, kind of like fish and lured into this thing, there needed to be a little cajoling on this, you know. And you were certainly great. And I knew like I would always probably be strolling in just at the start of the whole thing. Mm-hmm. And I needed somebody that really could be dialed in. And that was you. And it all worked out.
It was a little rough that first summer.
Well, there were vacations
that it needed.
Well, I was just going to say, Bill Parks
didn't show up to a show.
Bill Parks didn't show up. But here was the worst kicker. Like, we get into the second week. No, I don't know if Mike knows the story. We get into the second week, so we do the show. Dan and I are walking out. And he goes, yeah, and I was like, oh, this is so great. This is so much fun. This is going to be wonderful. Blah blah blah. Dan goes, yeah. So Tina, you know, Trish and I have a couple of. You know, weeks that we're going to be gone, we're going to be going to the Cape and, you know, I'm going to need you to cover. And I said, well, okay. I said, I got to get somebody to help me. And I do remember that first summer, every time that I covered, I brought somebody else in. I mean, I had John Velas come in. I had Ralph Figge come in one time. You know,
okay, one like, where you had Jim Wiggs come in.
Jim Wiggs. I mean, whoever, you know, I was like, I got to get somebody because at that point I didn't have the confidence. You know, I've done this. Pete and I have done this on our own. You know, we've had guests that have called in last minute. I'm sick. I can't come. It's like, yeah, we can go on for 2 hours, but back then,
the college was watching all this.
Then Dan says to me, so I said, okay, well, just you know, let me know when you know what the dates are. Well, you know, he whips out this calendar and he starts rattling. Well, it's this date and this date. I'm thinking it's gonna be like one or two. It was like five or six.
You were never around that.
That was a busy summer. Yeah. I stayed, Brent Bean wanted to be the sit-in mayor, you know, so I need to leave town for a little while. But Pete, I knew from the media department, right? And I knew what his background was. And I'm like, man,
Pete was working for IT.
I was IT, yeah.
He was working for IT at the department, the city's IT.
Yeah, because Mark was mostly handling the media stuff. And I'm like, who could really be this fill-in type person? And who could I have that same conversation with? And it turned out to be Pete because I know he couldn't say no.
Well, you had been on – I had started streaming because I was doing streaming.
Oh, we did. That's right.
The studio in my basement.
In your basement.
In his basement. Atomic Radio.
And we used to simulcast.
So that was the original streaming was on my website.
Right.
And then you – I had known your wife because she was a year behind me in school.
Yeah, school, right. Yep.
So I said – we were talking. I was like, well, I do this radio show thing in my basement. He's like, oh, I'd love to do that. And so next thing, Dan was down there for a couple hours.
12-pack of Sam Adams, and it was good.
Hanging out in the basement. Yeah. We were spinning tunes and shooting the breeze.
Yeah, that was a lot of fun. I do remember that. Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah.
All right. Okay. So that was it.
Yeah.
That was it. So now that we have those, you know, sort of we've set the stage for how all this started. We're going to talk about the evolution as we go along here. But, you know, we have to do some breaks. We have to do some music. We have to do some announcements. So I'm thinking about, you know, music. We've already played Glory Days because, you know.
Happy was big back then that summer.
That was big. There were all kinds of things going on. But I wanted to do a little tribute to each of us here. So we've all got a song here.
Ooh.
It's a name song. So we're going to start with Mike because he was management and working for Westfield State at the time. So you are listening to WSKB 89.5 FM radio for the Westfield masses and WCPC cable channel 15. This is our special 10-year anniversary edition. And in honor of management, Mike Knapik, we are going to listen to Peter, Paul, and Mary singing "Michael, Row Your Boat Ashore." We'll be back.
Michael, row the boat ashore, hallelujah. Michael, row the boat ashore, hallelujah. Sister, help to trim the sails, hallelujah. Sister, help to trim the sails, hallelujah.
Underwriting for Community Radio on WSKB is brought to you in part by Rockies. Over 30 convenient locations throughout Massachusetts, Rhode Island, New Hampshire, Connecticut, and Florida. One of the nation's largest Ace dealers. Expertise and great product selection in paint, hardware, lawn and garden. That's Rockies. Rock solid service since 1926. On the web at Rockies.com.
Listen to me, Michael Buster McMahon, Mondays 8 to 10 a.m. to learn the stories behind your favorite songs. Or don't. I'm not the boss of you.
Community Radio.
89.5 WSKB.
Live from Studio 120 at Westfield Technical Academy, this is WCPC Channel 15 and 89.5 FM WSKB Westfield.
Good morning, Westfield. It is 6:43. You're listening to WSKB 89.5 FM radio for the Westfield masses and WCPC cable channel 15. My name is Tina Gorman. I am your Wake Up Wednesday host on this special 10-year anniversary edition of Wake Up Wednesday. We have Pete Coles, the chairman of the board, behind the glass, and Pete has been with us the entire 10 years. And I have two men with me. My two guests are the Knapik brothers, Mike Knapik and Dan Knapik, who really helped to start all this, and we're talking a little bit now about kind of the history of how all this got started, and it really is interesting, you know, to kind of stroll back down memory lane. And Mike, at the time, we were talking about the fact that you were working at Westfield State University at the time. Dan, at the time, was mayor of Westfield, and just sort of trying to figure out how all this came together. And Dan was pointing out just before we came back on air that when we started that first summer, he and I were doing the show on Wednesdays and Friday mornings. And that was the only morning programming at the time. Mike, you were busy developing kind of what was going to happen in the fall with programming really Monday through Friday. That was the concept.
I think Bob came in July at some point. Bob Plass started
sure
in July.
I think he came in that soon. I don't think he was that early, did he?
Yep.
He was one
of the first ones.
He was.
And then we introduced like everybody else
later.
In September.
Okay. All right. So
it was pretty clear. Although just looking at the logo, right? So we created that bumper sticker back.
Yes.
And we had that all over town.
Oh, I meant to bring in my coffee mug, WSKB mug.
Well, we had swag, right? So we created swag.
Well, we had no other gifts to give out. Remember, we had no underwriters. They're like, hey, we're going to do these contests over the phone. We have to have gifts.
I know. See, Dan was the contest guy. Like, he would have these trivia contest things.
Yeah, that's right.
And how did Kenny Stomsky get involved with this, Dan? Because you brought Kenny in. How did you find Kenny?
So I had known Kenny for a number of years from the old karaoke days at the 252 nightclub, right?
Oh, dear God.
So
I knew there had to be a story there.
Well, anyway, so Kenny ended up, and I don't remember the exact name of it, but he ended up becoming a moderator of one of the Facebook forums. Westfield Dental, right?
Yeah.
And so he...
Facebook Kenny.
Yeah, Facebook Kenny, right? Kenny the Facebook guy.
He's like
a South Park guy. You know? I started talking to him about it because we were going back and forth on that page because that had a lot of history to Westfield.
Yes.
And I'm like, you know what? And I forget what the topics of the day were at the time, but... But he was obviously moderating the pulse of the people. Right? So I'm like, you know, Kenny could fill some slots. And then I found out later, you know, Kenny was, I believe he was electronics major here, you know.
At Westfield Tech. He graduated from Westfield Tech.
Right, so, and then he had a radio interest and all this other stuff in his electric. And he was working up in Northampton at the time, in the electronics store. So he just became a natural in, he brought a different perspective. He had some of the things that he does today were, you know, genocized back then, you know. And it was, so when the three of us were together, which didn't seem to happen all that often, it was, it made for a really entertaining morning session. You know?
Well, yeah, because Kenny was on Fridays. Yeah. But, of course, you know, Mr. Cape Cod over here was, there wasn't a whole lot of overlap that first summer with
Fridays. Well,
then eventually
I did move to Cape Cod, right?
That absolutely happened. Yeah. So, Mike, kind of bring us into how did we go from, you know, Wednesday mornings, the Wednesday-Friday slot, to then there was a time when it was 5 days, when we were doing Monday through Friday.
Yeah.
That Monday slot has always been a little bit challenging for, yeah, that was
Well, we still have the 8 to 10 slot.
Yes.
It's always been the curse has been the Monday 6 to 8.
Exactly. Yeah.
I've had like 4 different shows in that slot.
Yeah.
And it's never
at least, yeah.
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 If you can imagine, as we had this radio concept and talking to the students, it was their club. So being fully respectful of them, we had to find a block of hours that would not intrude on student programming, right?
And right.
So we knew right away that, well, who's up at 6 a.m.
at
the college, right?
Yeah.
So I think they were just playing the loop of songs and sometimes it would knock out and whatnot. So anyways, the 6 to 10, we agreed again in conjunction with working with them at a 6 to 10 a.m. time frame. And again, part of the allure for the students was we would help to bring in underwriters, you know, advertisers, who would bring resources into the college.
Yep.
We would share them and do better things with the studio. And, you know, so some of it was in self-interest. But, you know, the 6 to 10 a.m. slot was what was decided upon. But then to fill it, Pete, to your point, I mean, that could be, you know, 2 shows a day over 5 days. That's 10 shows a week. You know, in partly bringing Bob Plass in, you know, Bob is a showman, I think, as we all know that. But, you know, Bob helped. Yeah, well, I mean, Bob knows people.
Yes.
And the characters of Westfield, of course. So, Bob was able to help kind of bring some semblance of order to it. We talked about Bo. I think we brought Bo Sullivan in the fall of 2014. He was still working a little bit with WHYN Radio, and he brought some of that expertise to bear also.
Yes.
And somebody we actually hired on a contract basis, some of the folks from WHYN and that world to just help us with some of the mechanics of what was being done. So it was really approached from a real professionalization of it. And I think the students were always a bit skeptical of this because we're not, you know, are they going to take over the station?
Yeah.
Do things?
Yeah.
And so we had to, you know, first of all, we had no time to do that. We all had other jobs to do.
Exactly.
They didn't realize that, I guess.
No, I know. Well, they do now. But I had mentioned, you know, we started paying the station manager. So we began to provide some resources for internship because that was a lot of work for Jake. And Jake's grandfather was a longtime professor, Bob Leon, up at Westfield State. So, deep Westfield roots. But the next station managers who came in, I mean, that was a lot of work for them. We wanted them to meet Pete, to work with Pete, to wake up, in the morning when necessary and things like that. So that was good. And as I said, ultimately, we did provide some scholarships. And I know, Pete, I think one of the first things we did with the college was that hoot on the down on the green, hoot day.
Hoot day,
you brought the radio down.
Yes,
that was sort
I
of the coming out of WSKB in the community after you went through that rough summer of 2014 with all the aforementioned hurdles.
Working out the bugs.
It was fun.
It was fun.
It was, we did it. And the other thing, too, Mike, you might want to, if you recall, because I was thinking about this, that first year, you had Bay State. Well, at the time, it was Noble Hospital. It wasn't Bay State Noble Hospital, but they were like a major underwriter, and I know they, for my show, I had guests on from Noble, like, it was contracted that way. They had a 45-minute slot, whether it was every week or once a month or whatever it was. So, I mean, was great for me because it allowed me to bring on a lot of, the medical folks and...
We viewed that, as we looked at the arena, and Bo really helped with this, we looked at the arena of possible underwriters in Westfield, and Westfield had just created the nursing program up at Westfield State. And Noble Hospital is always a powerful partner of everybody, as is the Boys and Girls Club, YMCA, Stanley Park, the Air Base, the anchor institutions of Westfield. So they were a natural. And they had resources for advertising and marketing. And again, the community hospital marketing to the community through this vehicle was a powerful thing. So written in there, and you obviously were the key to that because you deal with a population that certainly accesses healthcare in a powerful way in their own right, the elders of Westfield and communities. So we brought them in with some specific parameters, which they were pleased to do.
Yeah.
This is before the affiliation with Bay State.
Right.
Which, again, Pete, you brought the whole radio crew down to witness Dr. Kerouac and the team from Bay State Health, Bay State Noble, Ron Bryant, the president and the trustees, signed the affiliation agreement, which I want to say was 7 years ago this summer. So it
sounds about right.
So that's how we, certainly using the radio station as a community resource, but then especially for the underwriter Noble Hospital, bringing in the expertise that is at the hospital to speak to the community, which is done through the newspaper, traditional means, and other things. But this is one more way to reach the people of Westfield. So it was viewed as a very powerful thing.
And I think, when we started that first summer, I mean, Dan and I were kind of all over the map. I mean, we were talking about drive-in theaters. We were talking, we were just sort of, there was a lot of reminiscing. And again,
you had to fill airtime.
We did. We had to fill airtime, but Kenny brought a different perspective with some of the historical stuff. But as we got into the fall, and then I think that's where your vision, and I think with Bo's and Bob's help, then it became, Tuesday was WOW. So that was more the culture. I had a lobby. I got, I'm going to tell viewer, I had a lobby to get my own show. Because by the end of the summer, I was like, I could do this. And so
we had people knocking at the door to do shows.
I'm sure that time.
Believe me, when she came with the news that she wanted to break up, I'm like, what?
No, because Dan said to me, he goes, I can't do the 6 to 8 because at the time you had to take the boys to school. So that was the thing. So you told me that over the summer. You're like, okay, come fall. You kept saying, it's like, I don't know what's going to happen because I can't do the 6 to 8 slot. And I'm thinking, I'm an early riser. I'm like, I can do the 6 to 8 slot. I can do this by myself. So I lobbied to management. Here I am 10 years later still doing the show. Yeah. But I think...
OG.
All kidding aside, Tuesday became cultural. And then the focus of the Wake Up Wednesday became health and wellness, sort of in the broadest sense.
Until I showed up in...
But then your show was, what was it called? The mayor's corner or something, whatever, from the corner office or something. I don't remember whatever it was. But you came on at 8 after me. Yeah. And sometimes a little after 8. I would get these text messages from Dan, I know you're still on the air, running late, I'll have to stop at Dunks. Just fill some time. I'll be there in about 5 minutes. So, which is fine because, as you all know, I could talk forever.
I was on time today.
Yeah, you were good. No, you were awesome.
Thank you.
So then you had your own show. Yep. And that was weekly when you were mayor. Weekly, that was a weekly show at 8. And then Thursday was, who was Thursday for a long time, Pete, before,
it was Patrick Berry.
It was Patrick Berry.
But it was originally, you guys somehow talked Patrick Berry into doing a four-hour show.
That was not easy, let me tell you, Pat. Yeah. I was just telling this to some
four-hour show. Was, yeah.
Yeah,
that
I said, you know, when we first approached Pat, he's like, no, I couldn't do that. I could not do that. And now look at him. He's a mass appeal.
I know, right?
This is what happens when you get proper training.
Exactly. Well, he got his, just remember, he got his start here. He didn't start on Mass Appeal.
He actually said that to me once. He goes, you know, I would have, having done this with you and figuring out how to do this and finding my groove, he says, I would have never even thought about applying for a job like that.
Yeah, that wouldn't have.
It would have never crossed my mind, even being in the media business on the newspaper
this
side.
This is what was hysterical. So you probably never heard this story, but, you know, when Patrick started his show, his own show, on those Thursdays in that fall, I met with him. He called me and he goes, okay, we have to have a meeting because I'm going to be I know you've been doing this all summer with Dan. And so, you know, I want to run by my, you know, what my thoughts are with you for my show. So I said, okay. So, you know, he's got like, I mean, he had it down to like, okay, I'm going to do this to, you know, and then at, you know, 6:11, I'm going to take a break, you know, and then at whatever, I mean, I'm already looking saying, well, I already blew through another break so we're going to have to take a break in a second. But, you know, it was just hysterical. And I said, you know, Patrick, I said, it's just going to flow. You know, and he was so nervous initially. He was really, really nervous initially. You know, you know, he said, that's a lot of airtime. And I said, I know, but, you know, you just kind of get into this groove. I said, Pete is there. I mean, he's just like your sidekick. And, you know, he's going to hold your hand and walk you through this. And yeah, so he said, now look at him. But it was just cracked me up because, you know, it was just his timing. I said to him, okay, like at 6:38, you're going to do this. And I said, you're going to be doing a lot of watching the clock. I said, I kind of keep an eye on it. And those were in the old days. I don't know if you remember, but when we were up at the radio station, there were no clocks in there. Zero
there
clocks.
I had a battery. It didn't work.
I couldn't see it from where I was, and it didn't work. It would always said like 10:30
in the
morning.
That's when I bought the big digital clock. Remember
right.
That?
But it took a while to get there. I had this little like purple, like my little purple clock. So I had my bag with all my
prep stuff.
And my little clock. Yeah. And every once in a while, my clock would go wonky. And I was like, Pete, here, reset my clock because it was a tech thing. All right. So I promise we're going to do a song for everyone. So Pete, I'm going to do a break now. And then a little after 7, we'll like do the top of the hour break because I'm all messed up, but that's okay.
Yeah.
All right, so we did a song for Mike. So we have to do a song for Dan. So I found a song, Dan. I have a song for you. So you are listening to WSKB 89.5 FM Radio for the Westfield Masses and WCPC Cable Channel 15. And in honor of my guest and my former co-host, Dan Knapik, we're going to listen to Michael Jackson singing Dapper Dan.
Do it, do it. He can do it. Watch him do it.
Support for Community Radio on WSKB is provided by Betts Plumbing and Heating Supply Company, an independent, family-owned wholesaler serving Westfield for over 50 years, specializing in plumbing, heating, and industrial piping supplies. On the web at BettsPlumbing.com or at 14 Coleman Avenue in Westfield.
This is Ken Stomsky from Ken's Den on WCPC 15 and 89.5 FM, Tuesdays 8 to 10.
Community Radio,
89.5 WSKB.
Live from Studio 120 at Westfield Technical Academy, this is WCPC Channel 15 and 89.5 FM, WSKB Westfield.
Go back to the original.
Good morning. I know. I was thinking, I'm like, oh my gosh, that, you know, I'm thinking that sounds familiar, Pete.
Yeah, I think it goes on forever, too.
It does. It does. That. Yeah. Okay.
Because I'd be late. I think it'd hear it rolling up West Avenue. I'm like, oh my God.
Good morning, Westfield. It is Wednesday, June 26, 2024. We are celebrating our 10-year anniversary here on the WSKB Wake Up Wednesday show. In the studio with me this morning, of course, the chairman of the board, Pete Coles, who has been with us the entire 10 years, and the Knapik brothers, Mike Knapik, who was the former management of WSKB, as he liked to
somebody
refer
has
himself.
To bring discipline.
Exactly. And we would get these emails from management.
Look at the style of dress. We know who the boss is.
Exactly. And former mayor Dan Knapik. And yeah, Dan and
I'm
I were
rigid.
Dan and I were co-hosts. Well, again, we're, you know, Dan and I are back to our days of it was radio. Nobody could see
summer
us.
Summer radio.
It was nobody summer radio. Nobody could see us.
Until Pete introduced the streaming part, which was almost there right from the beginning.
We are going to talk about that a little
bit. Just real quick. We were talking on the break about I tried to bring some discipline to the programming. You could do whatever you want in between, but people are used to sort of news and weather at the top of the hour, maybe the bottom of the hour, just to get a sense of what's going on. And how did we used to do the news and the weather here?
Yeah.
Well, you know, so it was easy for us. I mean, Pete was coming from the north side, which has its own weather pattern.
That's true.
Tina was coming in from the far east, right? Yep, and that has its own weather pattern after passes through Westfield. And we were able to work in traffic reports by saying, hey, how was it coming in from West Springfield weather-wise?
Or and Western Avenue, what was the traffic on Western Avenue?
And then what was the traffic on Western Avenue?
Right, what's the traffic on Route 20? And Pete would give the traffic on Route 10.
Those main arteries, right? So we got it all done in like 2 minutes. It was great.
And, you know, the funny thing was is we would get these emails from management. And, you know, initially I was, you know, like, oh, you know, all serious about this and everything. And then, except that I was hanging around him too much. I was like, yeah, don't worry about it, Tina, whatever.
As long as you don't swear.
Well, exactly.
Like
that.
We had that. We had protocol.
We did have protocol, exactly. And I
little thing that, called the FCC.
Yeah.
Thank you, Pete.
And it was funny because
seven words you're not supposed to say, right? Yeah.
Right. Exactly. And I remember when Patrick first started, one of his things when he sat down with me at that meeting and showed me his outline of, you know, down to the second. But one of his things was his music, and I have to say Patrick was the one who really got me focused on, you know, music, somehow coordinating in with either the topic or the guest or, you know, a holiday or, you know, whatever was going on. There was so that, you know, that kind of became a thing.
Well, you know, he had a huge executive staff with McKeever there, Jim McKeever.
Yeah, Jim McKeever.
Right? So Pat didn't really have to do a lot. He, you know, he didn't really start working until he opened up the bagel joint. You know, so that's why he had so much time. I would like to give a shout out because one of the earliest receptors of our program would be Danny Nason.
Danny Nason. We can't do a history show without including Danny.
So Danny would be listening faithfully while he was at work at the quarry, and he would be requesting songs.
He would call in.
Yeah, he was great that way. And also Billy Tatro, I believe, called in a few times.
Yes,
really,
he did.
To heckle us along the way. But Danny was, you know, always checking in on the signal. You know, while he was
And you'll never, I can't believe that I did this, but every week for my show, I send Dan I send Danny Nason a little, write-up of who my guests are, what we're going to be talking about, and he posts that wherever he posts it, social media. I forgot to do it this week. I was so out.
So the viewership is now going to be down. We're going to have to wait till it gets published.
Exactly.
YouTube, right?
It'll be on YouTube. All right, perfect. But I felt, I was driving in this morning going, oh my God, did I forget? Because usually I send the outline to Pete and then my next email is to Dan. But it's been a little wild and crazy at the Gorman household and at the office lately.
All right,
so
we'll give you a pass.
It's been a little nuts right now, and I am operating on not a whole lot of brain cells. All right, so we're back to that first fall when we started, Mike, and filling in all those days. So we were just trying to remember who was filling in where. So initially Monday, and as Pete said, Monday was always the hardest. The original concept, if you recall, Mike, was that it was going to be a nonprofit. We had four, I think, nonprofits that were going to rotate.
So go through, yeah.
So Bill, we already talked about Bill Parks from Boys and Girls Club.
I'd get a call from
not me. A morning person.
Be like 6:10. Bill didn't show up. Can you make it?
Yeah. Oh my God. So it was Bill's.
That was the first show that I was supposed to do with him.
Yeah. And so here we are. We'd been promoting it, and that was another thing. Management informed us, and I was really good at this, about promoting everybody else's show. So I would be talking about, I'm on Wednesday, Patrick's on tomorrow, and I would always find out from Patrick, who is your guest going to be? So I would kind of promote that. And so,
teasers. So you want the teaser.
You want the teaser. Yeah. So I had been promoting, the Monday show, and Bill Parks was going to be, and then Bill Parks was he slept through it. He slept through his first show. But who, and then we had Diana McLean, who was
she
working for the...
She kind of took over... became the host and then brought the nonprofits in.
Right. Okay.
Instead of nonprofits hosting their own show, she was kind of the host.
Okay. And that's right. That's right, Pete. You're right. And then she would bring people in.
She was a former, I believe. She had a former radio show as a student when she went here. So
I did not know that.
Yes, that was her thing. She liked. Okay. She wanted an opportunity. Of course, then she had a long career at Comcast before she ran into me.
Okay. I didn't know that.
Yeah. So she was a natural.
Did sales.
Yeah.
All right. So that was Monday. Then Tuesday was Bob Plass. That was so that was wow. And the whole cultural thing.
Yeah.
Dan and I for the summer had Wake Up Wednesday. Then I took that over in the fall. We talked about Patrick Berry had Thursdays. And then Fridays, we were talking about this. It was Jay Pagluca. And originally Bob and Jay were co-hosts on Tuesdays. And then Jay came back on Fridays and kind of did sort of a local talent. He was bringing in
local musicians and things.
And they
like
would
that.
Actually perform, they would perform at Westfield State
at
in
Westfield
the
State.
Studio.
Yeah, yeah.
And so that happened. And then
Jay was working full time back then, too.
I
was always amazed, because he traveled, his territory is quite large, that he would be able to dedicate all that time.
Yeah, I know. Yeah. That was pretty amazing. Yeah.
He's retired now, though.
He is just retired. Yeah, recently. I mean, that was
Monday,
and then
Monday's still available.
Monday is still available.
I'd like him to take Friday back.
Yeah.
We're trying to work out something for to do Friday.
Because Friday, what Pete, I think what you're doing now is kind of a sort of a best one of the shows from the week. So he'll run a repeat if whoever had the guest that did the best job, I guess, kind of thing.
Yep.
Is usually the Friday show, and then Saturday is polka, right, Pete?
Oh yeah.
Saturday morning polka.
We brought that on pretty early when the guys. That was one where the students
UMass.
Took back the station. WMUA. And all these poker guys that had been up there for years got booted, and they started their own streaming service called Poker Jammer.
Yep.
And we partnered up with them to simulcast them. They've been tickled pink about that still.
Yeah.
That's a very good
on the
for
FM.
Them.
Good. All right. Let's take a short break. You are listening to WSKB 89.5 FM radio for the Westfield Masses and WCPC cable channel 15. So this is really my top of the hour break, even though it's 8 minutes late. So that's kind of, it's the way we roll.
Typical.
To be expected.
We'll be back.
Support for the community programming of WSKB is provided by the Dunkin' Donut Shops of Westfield and the Sardinia family. It's nice to know that even as the world changes, Dunkin' Coffee remains the same at 7 convenient locations throughout Westfield.
Hi, this is Harry Rock, host of Rock on Westfield every fourth Wednesday at 8 a.m. Tune in for my view of this place I call home.
Community Radio,
89.5 WSKB.
Live from Studio 120 at Westfield Technical Academy, this is WCPC Channel 15 and 89.5 FM WSKB Westfield.
Good morning, Westfield. It is 7:12. You're listening to WSKB 89.5 FM Radio for the Westfield Masses and WCPC Cable Channel 15. My name is Tina Gorman. I'm your Wake Up Wednesday host, and I'm in the studio this morning for this special 10-year anniversary edition of Wake Up Wednesday with the chairman of the board, Pete Coles. Good morning again, Pete.
Good morning.
My guests this morning are the Knappick brothers, Dan Knappick, former mayor of Westfield, and the first Wake Up Wednesday host. Welcome again, Dan.
Thank you.
And Mike Knappick, who at the time, former Senator Knappick, but Mike at the time was working at Westfield State University and kind of spearheaded the effort to bring community radio back. He was the cat herder. Well said, Pete. Well said. So welcome
Thank you,
again.
Pete.
Welcome
exactly
again,
right.
Mike. All right. So one of the things, you know, we talked about kind of some of the loose format that Dan and I created. But one of the things that we did that we talked about, and I think Kenny helped me with this one too, was kind of, you know, going and looking up, you know, it's a national day, it's a month, an awareness month or whatever.
What happened on this day?
So today, June 26th, is actually National Barcode Day. And I thought to myself, all right, so the barcode, like, what am I going to say about this? Well, it's actually rather interesting. So National Barcode Day on June 26th commemorates more than 40 years of efficiency and accuracy that began on June 26th, 1974, when a clerk scanned a 10-pack of Wrigley's Juicy Fruit Gum at a Marsh supermarket in Troy, Ohio. On that day, the barcode system invented by George Lauer, an IBM engineer, began to change the world. Now, interestingly, I'm old enough to remember pre-barcode, and I remember somebody saying, oh, you're going to have this, you know, thing. Do you remember in the old days when you went to the grocery store, they
keyed
in, plugged in the price, you know? Yeah, it was very fast. And I remember somebody saying, oh, no, they're going to have this thing, and you're going to have lines on everything, and there's just going to be this little machine thing. And I remember saying, what the heck? What are you talking about? Well, there it is.
And now you have self-checkout, too.
Exactly.
Isn't that wonderful?
You got the barcode. So since then, barcodes have been revolutionizing industries all over the world. Barcodes, also known as UPC, one-dimensional codes, contain data that help businesses and organizations to do their jobs more easily. A more modern version of the barcode is called a QR code or a two-dimensional code. The QR code contains even more data than the 1D code. Barcodes contain a wealth of information, including pricing, product, dates, manufacturer, and shipping. They are ideal for tracking inventory and sales, but they do so much more than that. Almost every industry uses barcodes, and they likely make your life easier without you even knowing it. Where can you find barcodes besides retail products? Well, VINs. Tracking a car's history became easier when a barcode was added to the VIN. Libraries. Barcodes can track books, videos, periodicals, resources in and out of the library. Logistics. Every major shipper uses barcodes to track shipments and deliver your orders. Healthcare. Barcodes help keep patient care more streamlined and records at the provider's fingertips. And agriculture. Farmers use barcodes to track harvests and livestock. Imagine how different our lives would be without these unobtrusive black and white bars and that satisfying beep every time we scan a product, delivery, or file. It is certainly a technology that will be around for a long time, simplifying our lives. That's another reason to celebrate National Barcode Day. So who knew? You know, that is really true. And the funny thing is having, you know, been over at Bay State Medical Center recently, that's true. You know, they're scanning all kinds of stuff, and including your little bracelet, which, you know, used to just have your name and your birth date or whatever, and now there's all these little lines. So, yeah, very cool. All right, announcements. today at the Senior Center, we're going to have an ice cream social.
Oh.
But what's really cool about
this. Nice day for that.
It is. It's a good day for it. And what's really nice about this, it's hosted by Careforth. And what's really great about it is there's no charge, no tickets, no advance registration. All you have to do is show up to the Senior Center.
Mike and I are seniors.
I'm just
going to
say that.
You are seniors.
As am I.
Do
we need a barcode to get in?
No, you do not need a barcode to get in. This is no tickets, no advance registration. It's drop-in. It's complimentary for this cool and creamy treat.
Wow.
So it's at 12:45. So for those who signed up for an indoor lunch, this is going to be your dessert. But you don't have to have done that. You can just, because we have a lot of people who, you know, have a lot of things that they have to do. And, you know, they're taking classes and doing all kinds of other things in the morning. And it was funny because I heard Sandra, our front desk greeter, asking people yesterday, you know, did you remember about the, I did remember about the ice cream. Are you coming? I am coming. So 12:45 today, hosted by Careforth. And we do thank Careforth for that. I also want to remind folks, because this is Wake Up Wednesday, it is a health and wellness show. The farmer's market is in full swing now in Westfield. Yeah. Thursdays, noon to 5. In the front of the church, on the grounds of the Church of the Atonement. Parking is behind in the Church of the Atonement parking lot. And we do ask you to please, please park in that lot and don't park in the Arbor's parking lot, which a lot of people have done because, you know, you can just kind of cut across the front lawn. But please don't do that because the Arbor's really needs that for their residents and their visitors and their staff. So, but there is plenty of parking behind the church lot. It's at 36 Court Street. I will just review a few of the frequently asked questions about the farmer's market because it just started a couple of weeks ago. Can you bring your pet to the market? No. Please don't bring your pet. But if you have a service animal, you're allowed to bring a service animal, but not a pet. Because it gets kind of, you know, it's a lot of people there. We have a lot of seniors that utilize the market. We have walkers and all that. So service animals, yes. Pets, no. Does the market accept SNAP benefits, which is food stamps? And the answer is yes, they do. What I would suggest you do is stop by. There's a SNAP tent when you get there, and they're going to explain how you can turn $10 on your SNAP card into $20 to spend on eligible items at the farmer's market. The state is really trying to push, healthy eating, fresh produce, and so forth. So this is actually bonus money on your SNAP card. So stop by the SNAP tent. They'll explain it. If you need tokens, you can exchange your card, money on your card for tokens. But you can get up to $10 per day at the market if you have a SNAP benefit card. Also, HIP, which is the Healthy Incentives Program, which is also affiliated with SNAP, that gives you money per month. I think it gives you like $40 a month to spend on fresh produce, either at the farmer's market or at one of our local farms. So all good stuff. They'll explain it all at their tent. Can you use a credit card? And the answer is yes. Or a debit card? The answer is yes. Many of the vendors take those, and if they don't, you can actually get tokens. You can go to the tent. There's an information tent there, and you can get tokens for that. This is something that I learned, and I didn't know until last year. Does the Westfield Farmers Market sell gift certificates? And they do, because we play gift card bingo on Fridays, the last Friday of the month at the Senior Center, and we usually have gift cards to Stop and Shop and Big Y and the Dollar Store and Dunkin' and McDonald's. But last year I started giving, we started doing, adding the farmers market during the summer months. So you can do that. Is there a bathroom available? There is, in the Church of the Atonement. And there's a volunteer inside the building that will provide you with a key. Are the same vendors at the market every week? And the answer to that is not necessarily. Some of the vendors are there every single week. Some of the vendors rotate based on what their crops are. So if there's a certain time of the year when, you know, it's blueberries or strawberries or, you know, whatever the vegetable or fruit is that they sell, you might see those vendors just, you know, those certain weeks. But there are usually at least 20 vendors, 20 to 30 per week. So you have a lot of options there. And the last question is, will the market be open in bad weather? Generally, it's open rain or shine unless it's like a thunderstorm. And then you can go to their Facebook page, the Westfield Farmers Market Facebook page, or Instagram feeds, and they'll let you know if they've had a shutdown or if they're closing down. One more announcement that I want to make before we take our next break is, as you know, this is Pride Month. We've been celebrating here in Westfield with a variety of programs for Pride Month. There was an ecumenical service, a non-denominational ecumenical service that was scheduled for this past Sunday, but because of the tornado watch or warning or whatever we had, they postponed it to this coming Sunday. It's at the Methodist Church, 7 o'clock on Sunday. And I'm here to tell you, of all the Pride events that I've been involved with, I was involved with last year, this was absolutely my favorite. It was so meaningful. There are four churches that are involved, the two congregational churches, First and Second, the Methodist Church and the Church of the Atonement. Pastors all got together, planned this service. They do it at the Methodist Church on Court Street. It's an hour. It'll go from 7 to 8. Last year, it was just so meaningful. So you don't have to be particularly religious, but you don't have to be, you know, a member of the LGBTQ community. You can be an ally. You can just be somebody who, just wants to get a meaningful service in their lives. So it'll be this Sunday, June 30th, at 7 o'clock from 7 to 8. All right, you are listening to WSKB 89.5 FM radio for the Westfield Masses.
Tina.
I know, but I'm trying to do two things at once, and senior I shouldn't moment. Do that. Nope, not a senior moment. Just trying to do. My mouth is talking. My brain is on the next thing. And WCPC cable channel 15. So we are playing songs for everyone. Well, I couldn't really leave Pete out because Pete has been with us since the beginning. So Pete, we have a song for you. It is called "A Man Called Peter." It is by Ray Price. We will be back.
I met a man called Peter when my dreams had gone astray. And as I talked with Peter, my care just stole away. A kind and humble man was he who set my heart aglow. Somehow I found in every word the faith I needed so. Contentment I was seeking to make my life worthwhile. And suddenly my soul was free and my heart began to smile. Somewhere this man called Peter helps people just like me. If there were more like Peter, what a great world this would be. Contentment I was seeking to make suddenly my soul was free and my heart began to smile. Somewhere this man called Peter helps people just like me. If there were more like Peter, what a great world this would be.
Underwriting for the community programming of WSKB is provided by the Boys and Girls Club of Greater Westfield, serving the youth of the Whip City and surrounding communities since 1969. For more information on the Great Futures Club for ages 3 to 5, happening weekdays, and the Club Teen Center for ages 11 and older, weekdays from 6:30 till 8 p.m., go online at bcgwestfield.org or visit the club at 28 West Silver Street. The Boys and Girls Club of Greater Westfield. Great futures start here.
Saturdays were made for polka. Tune in to the Polka Jammer Network starting at 6 a.m. and Polka Hall of Famer Billy Bolina breakfast at BB at 8:30.
Community Radio.
89.5 WSKB.
Live from Studio 120 at Westfield Technical Academy, this is WCPC Channel 15 and 89.5 FM, WSKB Westfield.
Good morning, Westfield. It is 7:26. You're listening to WSKB 89.5 FM, radio for the Westfield masses, and WCPC Cable Channel 15. My name is Tina Gorman. This is our special 10-year anniversary edition of Wake Up Wednesday. Joining me in the studio is Pete Coles behind the glass, producer Pete, and the Knapik brothers, Dan Knapik and Mike Knapik, who really helped to get all of this started. So we're going to talk in just 1 minute about the transition to from strictly radio to moving over here to Westfield Technical Academy and the Channel 15, the city kind of taking that over. But before we do, I have two more announcements to make.
You're killing us with these announcements.
I know, but these are important. So we did the farmer's market.
They are.
So we have at Stanley Park this weekend, we have two events coming up. And this one I have to talk about because my daughter will kill me if I don't. Because now I have a granddaughter. True. So I'm paying attention to children's programming. So the summer series, which, Dan, we started talking about this 10 years ago. So they do a summer concert series for children at Stanley Park every Friday morning from 10 to 11. So it kicks off this Friday, June 28th. Tom Knight, it's called Look Both Ways. It's a puppet show. He's a wonderful entertainment, a pinch of puppetry, a dash of music, and a sprinkling of educational classes for young children. He's been doing this for 35 years. So this performance is going to take place in the Pavilion Annex, which is located behind the Rose Garden, not in the Beverage Pavilion. Most of them will take place in the Beverage Pavilion, but this one is in the Pavilion Annex located behind, y'all know where the Rose Garden is. So that's this Friday from 10 to 11. And so, yes, my daughter and my granddaughter will be there. And then the Sunday Night Concert Series, which is in full swing.
It's been very popular.
I understand they have literally had thousands of people going over there. Yeah. So this week, this Sunday, which that's from 6 to 8, the performer is Sweet Hitchhiker. This is a Creedence Clearwater Revival tribute band. So ought to be a lot of fun. And so that's on Sunday night. So there you have it. All right. So back to the matter at hand, which is, you know, WSKB. And
it's 7:28 Wednesday.
How was the
76
traffic, Mike?
Degrees.
Oh, it's 76
how
degrees.
How was the traffic
It wasn't bad from Lozierville. I appreciate your asking.
Traffic was good. Yeah, we're supposed to be doing traffic.
A lot of construction in the city.
You know, the traffic.
There's a reason I put the clock up on the TV.
The traffic.
Thank you, Peter.
The traffic from West Springfield wouldn't have been bad, except there was one guy. I pulled out of my street. And one guy who's poking along. This was at 5:10 this morning. And I'm like, seriously? And he poked along all the way down to Little George's. And now we make a right-hand turn, and it's a single lane over there now.
Right, right.
So I'm behind this guy, like, all the way to, you know, to East Mountain Road. And I'm thinking, seriously? Oh. Like, I got a show to get to. Yes!
Road
thank
dog.
You, Pete.
You were one of those women drivers. Like,
I mean, he was, but and even if he was doing the speed limit, I would have been okay. But we were doing about 25. And I'm thinking, okay, it is 30 on Dewey Street. And then it is 40 when we get out to Route 20, but we were not doing that. All right. So how did we get from Westfield State University to here? Who wants to jump in and tell me? Because I honestly don't even know this story.
I might just jump in real quick because one
ahead.
Of the things was aspirations at the time. Would be a thing about this. So we had a robust conversation when we talked about going to TV and whatnot. In the original concept that we talked about over at the press room, was that there would be a downtown TV studio.
Yep.
Patrick's were the, were what was
that's
the,
right.
the press room?
It's
where
the
his newsroom
right?
was.
Yeah, the bagel place, yeah.
So that was going to be the newsroom. He wanted, his pitch was people can see news being generated.
Yep.
We'd have a TV show, and it would be right there at the corner. Because remember, you know, economically, things were a lot different back then. And it was, you know, he had the concept of, like, this would hopefully drive a little bit of traffic down there. So we started, you know, the other thing that, you know, access to the college became difficult for the general public, for sure.
As the college became more popular, more students.
Right. In this concept would put it downtown, foot traffic, opportunity. The dorm was right across the street now.
Yep.
And there was, you know, obviously parking and whatnot. And so that was what kind of like we had latched on to when I was still in office.
Okay, yeah.
And then, you know, we did talk a little bit about doing something here. But one, you know, interestingly, Comcast broadcast. They used to broadcast. I believe it was at the old Chestnut Middle School in Springfield. And it's the same problem with schools. Schools became a problem because you can't have free flowing public going through because of the security concerns, right? So I didn't. There was some talk about doing something here, but it was like, yeah, logistically, that's going to be kind of difficult, you know. Okay. And that's where I left off on that conversation.
Okay. And so, Pete.
How did it end up here?
Yeah, so how did it end up here?
Well, it never kind of, with Patrick, it was kind of like, all right, we wanted to start a program. The big thing was they wanted to start a program in the school, a Chapter 74 vocational program.
Yep.
And then how do you get the students over there for practical time? It's almost like they do with the aviation students.
Right.
You'd have to get a vehicle for them to come over there for the day and then back and forth. And it became a kind of logistical nightmare. And then everything kind of like lagged for a while on the city side because the city moved slowly. I mean, just that's how it is. Just, you know, things move slowly.
Municipal government.
So it came to a point where Stefan made a really big pitch to have it here. Mm-hmm. And he was willing to carve out space in a graphic arts department that was rapidly changing because they didn't need as much room for the print part of it because you didn't need the presses anymore because the digital presses were becoming better and better and better, where you didn't need as much room for equipment, and they were able to carve out this space. But we originally started coming here when the press room closed.
Yep.
We started doing all of our Thursday shows here in Tiger's Pride on the stage.
That's right.
Yeah. So Dan would come down here occasionally to check in with WTA and do shows down here under the Friday show.
Right.
And then Kenny did it after Dan left. Continued to do shows down here. And when Patrick closed, we did the press room live because I was able to do streaming and we were able to make that work.
Yep.
And then Patrick closed the press room when he went in for shoulder surgery. Mm-hmm. And when he came back from shoulder surgery, we were doing all our shows on the stage at Tiger's Pride every Thursday morning.
Okay.
So it was kind of tough for them because we'd get done at 10 and they'd have to be ready. They'd have to be, you know, up and ready for 10:45.
Right.
So we started doing on the stage at Tiger's Pride, all of our Thursday morning shows.
Okay.
And then that was around the time that I got the job that I'm in now. And we started building out this space. And we originally moved in with two folding tables in the studio because the control room wasn't built. And everything else, and I was doing a ad hoc setup on another table in the studio with you guys, and then eventually I built all this out, and you know I got moved to the control room, and you guys wanted me to still be part of the show, so that's why I had to buy a camera for in here and things like that. So
I know,
yeah,
and so
it's progressed slowly but surely. I mean, think about it. In 2018, we moved into this studio. I got the job. In 2019, I was doing all of the 350 events.
Right.
And then it really hasn't slowed down since then.
Yeah, no, that's right. Yeah. We were talking off air earlier before one of the breaks about the broadcasting the football game, the Thanksgiving football game.
Yep.
Like, talk about that. Yeah, Pete, we
did a couple of them high school games. And then we also did a couple of Westfield State simulcasts.
Well, Pete, we were looking to raise money, so we actually had Thanksgiving Day sponsors underwriting.
Right.
There was a package of sports. We partnered with Dick Lundfest up there at the college. You're right.
Yeah.
And, you know, we remember back as kids, you know, it was WLDM. The Westfield station would broadcast for all of Westfield. I mean, with all due respect to the Panthers of Cathedral, who no longer exist.
That's right. They're not there.
Just saying.
That's right.
Easy.
Bombers, number one. But as kids growing up, and, the elders and everybody remembers the Bomber. Every other year, you'd be playing at Bolin's, and WLDM would be broadcasting live. Who were the hosts?
Dick Sullivan.
Yeah, Dick Sullivan.
Yeah. John Burke.
For years. And that's when Bo came on, you know, Dick, of course, being Bo's dad. I mean, we talked about that at the time. And, you know, we had Nick O'Dell, I think, was a student at Westfield State. And
Mike Giroux.
Yeah, who did all of this. So I don't know if that's still done or any of those sports shows.
No, they don't do any sports shows anymore.
But it's because it was partially because we tried to get more sports on the air. And the students that were doing the music had no interest in sports at all, and they kind of pushed back hard.
Because the timing was not the same. Yeah, we'd be interrupting programming.
But we did do some live broadcasts though with Pete at Bullens for a playoff game a couple years ago. I broadcasted I think a couple football games.
We did the 2016 World Series,
right, and we did the World Series was another.
That was during the summer, so the students weren't here.
Right.
They just said, "Yeah, whatever."
and then we did a simulcast with the. was it Mount Hope, Arkansas or something, the station that was the original genesis of the Turkey Toss?
Mountain Home.
Yeah, Turkey Toss on WKRP. So we actually talked to the host live during a game. From there, we talked about the WKRP broadcast, you know, and the
Mountain
Turkey
Home,
Toss.
Arkansas.
Yeah, that was you know, so there were some really cool things done on that topic. And Pete and I have periodically talked about trying to get more sports activities covered. It's logistically, it's difficult. Yeah. I, you know, when I get a little bit more time, I'd like to try to go and revisit that because
it's tough nowadays to find a crew.
A crew, that's part of the problem. But it does, you know, I think when we did, I forget which team it was, but the football team we played a few years ago in the state playoffs, they had a professional radio station come and they had their own professional broadcasters in the booth with us, you know. And so some places, you know, they have that dedication, they put resources at it, and they do it. But, I think, like, obviously there's other opportunities. It's easier to, like, kind of gear up for, like, a big event like the World Series or something like that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, now, you know, and now that we have the program that's going for Chapter 74 certification,
right, correct,
here, I believe they're going to try for it this year, is I really want to start pushing those kids to start crewing events. We found out that some kids you'd ask them to volunteer and they wouldn't. And then all of a sudden they were like, oh, well, we enjoy doing that. They did graduation with us and stuff
that
like
fun.
That.
Yeah.
And they were like, oh, well, we like doing that. Yeah. And it's different nowadays.
Yeah,
it is. You know, Pete, you'll also recall, or back in the early days, and Dan, you probably will too. Remember that first New Year's Eve?
The New Year's Eve ones?
The countdown.
I cruised in, I remember, just before
midnight. Yes, you did, my friend. Yeah. Gary and I were there. Yeah. There were all kinds of people there. Yeah.
What year did you look back on?
It was the 80s, 84? But the same year. Yeah.
83, yeah.
Right, it would be the same year. We did that for several years. That was when we were up at the college.
Yeah, we did it a couple of years here, too, but then everybody stopped coming. Because
we're all old now.
Me and Kenny looking at each other going,
by 9:30.
That's the problem. It's like nobody's staying up until midnight.
Take a nap. Oh, it was me and Kenny looking at each other, and we're like, this is the last time we're doing this.
Yeah, I know. But it was fun. You know, back in the day, it was a lot of fun. And I think a lot of the hosts now have, I know Bob has done it, and I've done it too, where we've brought in some guests. You know, one of my first people that I brought in when I was doing Wake Up Wednesday, other than my husband Gary, who did the show with me for probably about six or seven years monthly, was Jennifer Jaffune. Jenna's a registered dietitian, licensed nutritionist. Yeah. And I thought, you know, that would be great. It would be great to do a nutrition segment. So Jen came on board once a month, and then she started doing, during the pandemic, when we had closed the senior center to the public, she had just started a support group for folks with diabetes at the senior center. She used to do it at Noble Hospital before it was Bay State Noble, but back, that's when I first met her. And so during the pandemic, we kind of did the support group online. We would do it on air where, you know, she would have a particular topic and I would send out, you know, an email or a phone call to all of the people that participated in the group while we were, you know, in person. She's back to doing it now in person at the senior center, and we've changed her segment. And we've broadened it back to, we call it food for thought. So it's just kind of a healthy eating. And she has some really interesting topics. You know, like I'll email her and I'll say, or I'll text her and say, okay, do you have a topic in mind? And she now does too, because she's doing the monthly support group. So she's got something that she's doing for them. And then she's got, you know, whatever we're doing on air. So, you know, so she was one person. For a while I had somebody from the Board of Health. Joe Rouse joined me from the Board of Health monthly. You know,
Healthy
again,
Joe.
It was kind of, you know, just sort of a, you know, an update on what was going on. And that was even before the pandemic. He had actually started on Kenny's show. And all then right, yeah. I had him as a guest. I had Joe on as a guest for a particular topic. And we all kind of decided it just makes more sense to have him on, you know, the health and wellness show. So he kind of transitioned over here. But I think Bob has done that too, right, Peach? He has kind of his
medleys.
Yeah, I mean, he's got, you know, I think Jessica's been on, you know, monthly
years,
for
Kevin
a while.
Coughlin.
Yep, Kevin Coughlin, oh, yeah, Kevin Coughlin, Dental Matters.
We tried to get a political show in, right? We're still working on that.
We used to have rotating mayors, and the only person that's still doing it, believe it or not, and he's not even in elected office anymore, is Joe Didi.
Yes.
And we still have the Southwick show. Two of the three select persons.
They rotate. Yep.
Everything Southwick is still doing.
Joe's a listener, by the way, because I know, because we've talked about a few issues and Joe chimed in, right? So I know he listens.
He's a riot. He is hysterical when he comes in.
Yeah, so Joe still does his. I let him take a break after he lost the election because he probably would have had choice words for me had I asked him right off the bat.
We're back to certain words you can't say on air. So we had to dismiss.
Peter, it's 7:41 a.m., 76 degrees. So, all right.
Where's Bo? He was supposed to stop in. So Joe's still around. Who's come along a long way is Mark Auerbach.
Yeah. Yes.
Caught the radio bug again.
Yes.
With doing Artsbeat as an extension of what he did with the paper.
Yeah.
And then during the pandemic, he started a series called How We Doing? And he would do extra interviews with people that were just of interest to him. And that has evolved into On the Mark, which is stuff that doesn't really fit into the Artsbeat category. But he talks to people. I mean, we've had the guy that wrote On Golden Pond and Marsha Mason.
Yeah, he really brings in some incredible guests.
Deborah Jo Rupp. We've had some guests from all over the world on the Artsbeat show.
Yeah. You had some great WTA students on the other day.
Yeah, that was the show they did up at the Hangar.
At the Hangar,
We've also been on the road with Mark. So we just shot two episodes at Chester Theater. Got to see Don up there.
Nice.
And then we did three episodes at the Mahawi Theater out in Great Barrington. So we're on the road. He wants to do Goodspeed Opera and theater works in the fall. So he gets us on the road too. So
awesome. All right. It is 7:42. You're listening to WSKB 89.5 FM Radio for the Westfield Masses and WCPC Cable Channel 15. So, you know, I did a song for all of you people. And I thought to myself, I don't think there's a song with the name Tina. I was wrong. There is a song, and the title of the song is Tina, and you'll never believe who sings it.
Paul Anka.
No.
No?
Frank Avalon.
Frank Sinatra.
Wow.
So we are going to listen to
my song.
It's called Tina by Frank Sinatra. We'll be back with this special anniversary edition.
Can't forget her the moment you have met her. Your heart will never ever be the same. Tina, Tina, nobody else but Tina. That's the little lady's name. Gone and kissed her, give up, you can't resist her. Your thoughts will wear her picture like a frame. Tina, Tina, nobody quite like Tina. That's the little lady. She'll merely smile, and in a twinkling, you'll swear that smile contains a star. Before that smile, you had no inkling how much in love you really are. For angels, I have no time for angels. I've found someone more than just divine. Tina, Tina, no, sir, you can't have Tina. Tina is mine, oh mine. Tina is
Support for community radio on WSKB provided by Westfield Electroplating. Employing over 140 skilled platers, painters, and technicians, Westfield Electroplating was founded in 1946 and was the first company in the country to achieve National Aerospace and Defense Contractor Program accreditation, proudly maintaining that status for over a decade. Westfield Electroplating provides over 50 quality finishes to meet your corrosion, cosmetic, or performance needs. On the web at www.westfieldplating.com or 413-568-3716. Westfield Electroplating, putting the finishing touches on technology.
Hi, this is Harry Rock, host of Rock on Westfield every fourth Wednesday at 8 a.m. Tune in for my view of this place I call home.
Community Radio,
89.5 WSKB.
Live from Studio 120 at Westfield Technical Academy, this is WCPC Channel 15 and 89.5 FM, WSKB Westfield.
Good morning, Westfield. It is 7:47. You're listening to WSKB 89.5 FM, radio for the Westfield masses, and WCPC Cable Channel 15. My name is Tina Gorman. I'm your Wake Up Wednesday host on this special 10-year anniversary edition of Westfield. Wake up Wednesday. My guests this morning are the Knapik brothers, Dan and Mike Knapik, and Pete Coles is, of course, behind the glass over there. So we've had a great time really reminiscing and really talking about, you know, how all this got started and the evolution and what's happened over the 10 years, our change from just we started as radio. Now we are radio as well as Channel 15, cable channel. 15, so that's been exciting. But we are all four of us are really in different roles, not necessarily in different places of employment. Pete and I still work for the city, but we're all in different roles. So I'm going to talk about where you are now. So I'm going to start with you, former Mayor Dan. You started the show 10 years ago, have had a number of different places. You've worked for the state and you've been a town administrator out on the Cape. What are you doing now? Where are you now?
Yes, I took a very circuitous route to get back to Westfield.
Well, and that's okay.
Right? Well,
it's all part of the growing and the growth and the personal,
I was pursuing some personal aspirations, you know. But so now I find myself working every day in downtown Springfield for a non-for-profit management company called Partners for Community as the president and CEO. And one of the roles that we have that organization is we help to, for lack of a better word, incubate new and upcoming non-for-profit organizations. So we provide IT services, HR services, fiscal services, general management oversight services and whatnot. And our largest affiliate is a company that is actually a Massachusetts corporation, but it's based out of Connecticut. We take care of a number of adults with intellectual disabilities.
Okay.
So we run about 7 overnight homes throughout Western Connecticut, from the New York border to Hartford, down from the Mass border down to Bridgeport. And a number of, I think we're going to open up 2 more day programs, make it 6 day programs. Each day program roughly cares for about 50 individuals. And one of the hallmarks that the corporation has had is the skilling up of these individuals so that they can be vital and active members of community. You know, so one of the things particularly that I got, educated on, if you will, is the school system. Remember Sherry Erlander, of course?
Yes.
Sherry's program would take care of children from the time they would enter the school system till they were 22. That's the federal law where they age out. And so what we do after that is we take from there, we build off of what's happened at the public school level in the state of Connecticut. And so we've had, since I've been there in June of 2021, actually I just had an anniversary there, June 7th.
Nice.
A number of individuals, because that company's been around since 1980, stay with us for their entire adult livelihood until they pass away in our care, you know?
Yeah, that's amazing.
It is amazing, you know, and you know, it's what I got to know working a lot with Sherry is the struggles and challenges that the parents face as they age.
Yes.
And as we age, you know, we're thinking like, I can't even remember. Well, good thing we got on the radio now because I can hardly remember anything anymore. But there was a family here in town that we have now housing for their 3 children. And that was what struck me the most about this was we need to make sure as parents that after we go, our children are cared for appropriately, you know?
Yes.
And so we take that role and very serious on that. The corporation should probably surpass about $20 million this year in that arena. We have about 170 employees, looking to get to about 200 this year. But the work that they do, it's absolutely phenomenal. I mean, you know, and what the average person who doesn't interact in this world doesn't see is the folks that care for these individuals are not, they're making, you know, somewhere between $17 and $20 an hour, you know, and they're our most vulnerable citizens. And it's nice, you know, we run a landscape company, a thrift store, a cleaning company. So to the extent possible, that's the real goal of the program, is so that they can optimize their opportunity in life, you know.
Yeah.
And then the other very successful affiliate that we've had is the Latino Economic Development Corporation, which was seated with the Springfield delegation, Holyoke delegation. Senator Vilas was part of this for Holyoke as well in Chicopee, with originally $350,000 worth of ARPA money that came in.
Mm-hmm.
And we gave out dozens of grants in the Chicopee, Holyoke, and Springfield area. We're actually wrapping up, I think the last of that grant just went in to close the book on 350. But our director of that program recently obtained $1,100,000 of additional federal and state economic development programming to keep the ball rolling. And one of the things that that corporation does and has identified and has been very successful down in Boston is most of the traditional grant programs for businesses, if you were looking at financing for anything, a bank. Well, you know, a lot of the new businesses, I had my own business years ago, you're not going to get to that hurdle. You have no credit. You're new. You don't have any secured contracts. And then if it was a government-based grant, it was always based on W-2 employment, which was you had to be somebody's employee to get access to the grant. So we were successful in convincing the new Secretary of Labor and the staff down in Boston that you need to think about, you know, these startups, and what's powering a lot of the urban centers in not just in Massachusetts but across the country is the growth of Latino based enterprises, and those are typically family, like we have here in town, right?
Yes,
family generated, right? And that's normally the story of any brick and mortar operation when it starts. It's a family thing. They're not eligible for those things, and so we fill that gap. We often use other leveraged funds that they can get through a partner bank or something like that. And the whole idea is to have those businesses become stabilized enough so that they can become vital. If they get to the 5-year mark, they're usually in pretty good shape. Yeah. And we have a number of businesses that we've helped and supported that are helping drive the downtown economy in Springfield. And I'm really, you know, pleased with the team and the work that they've done. And you know, like I said, that is the economy of the future.
Yes,
know, there's no question.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Well, thank you. That's great and fascinating and really good work.
Thank you.
And Mike, you are over at Bay State Health now. And how long have you been there?
6.5 years at Bay State Health. I'm their Vice President of Government Community Relations, and you know, the word community part of the title, but that's really the beauty of what we've talked about this morning with the radio station, with Westfield State and whatnot. But if folks haven't noticed, there's a little bit of government in healthcare.
Yeah, just today, a little.
So I actually help with the strategy for Bay State Health, which is the largest employer in Western Mass, about 13,000 employees, full and part-time. And as we know, a system of community hospitals, one situated right here in Westfield, another one up in Greenfield, one up in over in Palmer, and then obviously the flagship hospital in Springfield, Bay State Medical Center. Together, they provide about 60% of all the healthcare in the 91 corridor, very complicated world of work and the workforce and whatnot. But, you know, great partnerships with places like the Westfield Tech Academy and their healthcare programs, Westfield State, the nursing programs. And just as we work to meet the needs of providing access and care for patients in the Western region. And we're fortunate that, you know, Bay State Health still has a local board of trustees, different than some of the other hospitals in the region, right? Trustees from Westfield, from Southwick, from Springfield area in the community making decisions. And, you know, Ron Bryant is our regional president of all of our three community hospitals, but lives here in Westfield, has been part of Noble, as we know, been on the show, underwriter of this programs.
Yeah.
He's programming for years, but Ron has done a nice job with Bay State Noble, and part of that affiliation was investments by Bay State into Noble, e-medical records, you talked about all those barcodes, all of that, you know, the physical plant, and you know, one of the big plans, and it's not really a secret, is to build a new emergency room here in Westfield, and we have a new president at Bay State, Peter Banko.
We do. too.
Just came in 3 weeks ago, and only the fourth president in Bay State Health's history, and he's already spoken about the need for an emergency room over here. So we look forward to working with him. There's great doctors, there's great nurses, great personnel at Noble, and we want to keep local healthcare strong, and that's all part of the mix.
And in your role, Mike, how are you sort of interfacing with Beacon Hill kind of thing?
Yeah, so all the legislators that some of whom I served with back in the day, but certainly the ones, say, Senator Vilas, Representative Pease here in Westfield, you know, I work with them to understand, you know, the complex role of healthcare, how we meet the needs in the communities, what we need in terms of resources, right?
Yeah.
I mean, the workforce challenge that everybody is facing is particularly acute in human services and healthcare.
Yes.
You know, we're 24/7, 365, very difficult, the new generation, and we're seeing this generational shift of workers from the older boomer, young boomers to obviously Gen X and even less, but the biggest cohorts are the younger generations, the millennial and Gen Z, very different work expectations than the previous generations. And that's part of it. Most of the patients obviously are in Medicare, and so that connect has got to be more powerful too. So we work with the legislators on workforce development, on growing programs with partners like the Tech Academy, like Westfield State, like our community college partners. And it's hard work, but it's absolutely critically necessary. And then making sure Bay State is strong for Springfield, whether it's through the DeMoor Center, some of the neuro work that we do, some of the specialty services, the neonatal intensive care unit. You know, we provide the only care in so many areas so that people don't have to go to Boston.
Right.
And that was the vision of Bay State Health almost 50 years ago.
And that's huge. I mean, that's just a big deal. I mean, my seniors don't want, you know, they
don't
want
to go to Springfield.
They don't want to go to Springfield. They want to go to Noble. Yeah. They want to go to Bay State Noble. And if they have to, then they'll, you know, cross the river and go to Springfield. But they certainly are not going to, you know, be trucking out to Boston if they can avoid it.
Exactly right.
Well, I want to say thank you, but I also want to do my own personal shout out to Bay State Health because in the last 11 months, I've had two experiences at Bay State Health. My granddaughter was born there. I was lucky enough to be in on that birth. It was fabulous. I can't say enough. And I really meant to like sit down and write all this and, you know, send Kathy Tobin a letter and all that. We had a newborn living with us and it was hard to do that. But I can't say enough about the care. It was absolutely fabulous. And just recently, you know, and now by now the word is out. So my husband, Gary, had a second open heart surgery at Bay State, second time at Bay State. First one was 8 years ago. First one, very successful. 14 months later, he ran a half marathon in Dublin, Ireland.
No kidding.
So, yeah. So, you know, the surgeon, Dr. Russo, said to him, Gare, we'll get you there, but it's going to be a little bit longer. You're 8 years older. You know, we had to go through some scar tissue from the first surgery, but he's doing well. And again, you know, I can't say enough about Bay State. And, you know, people said, oh, did you go to Boston? And I remember for his first surgery, he got a second opinion. And the Boston doctors basically said to him, why would you come out here for heart surgery? You have Bay State. We're not going to do any better out here for a heart surgery. So we said, okay, that's great. And I'm driving there, you know, a couple of weeks ago, day of his surgery, and I'm thinking, this is so great. It's like 12 minutes from my house to get, get to Bay State. It's so convenient. But again, great care. Those scanners were all over the place, and you know, which is real. It's very comforting, you know, just knowing that.
Well, and that's the role. My goal is to keep healthcare strong in Western Mass, in Westfield, and make sure it's available for folks. And that's what we do every day. And we thank the legislators, the congressmen, and senators and others. It's critical.
And a lot of it is just, you know, it's an educational process, just so everybody knows what everybody's doing.
So Tina, before we wrap,
we
used to do on my show like the last 5 minutes was a toss up, right?
Yeah,
we used to do the topic of the day.
Yeah.
So I'm not going to do a toss-up, but I would like to have one question to ask you because this is kind of timely.
Okay.
We used to kid you unmercifully.
Mm-hmm. I know what you're
And your husband
asking.
Was in on it.
Mm-hmm.
Do you have a Facebook presence yet? No.
And I said 10 years ago, it's not going to happen. It will. Nope.
Because we used to kid you all the time
and
about that.
Read today's Westfield News.
Person without Facebook. It's Tina Gorman on Wake Up Wednesday.
Well, congratulations.
That was JPEG Luca. But, you know, read today's Westfield News. Yeah. There's a piece in, I think, on the last page, like Dear Annie or whatever it is, about someone who wrote exactly about that and said, I used to do it. I used to be on social media, got off for a whole bunch of different reasons. And I'm reading this going, and that is the reason. And, you know, honestly, it was a time factor for me. And I'm still way more face-to-face. Gary and Grace kind of, yep, you know, let me know. I know Harry's waiting in the wings.
I still have the hope, you know, I have a yes version of that bump, too.
There you go. Okay, we'll see if that ever happens, Pete. But tomorrow is, I have to do this shout-out to my husband, Gary. Tomorrow is our 43rd wedding anniversary.
Holy wow. Congratulations.
So as we head out of here, this is my song for Gary, "You're Still the One" by Orleans. Oh. You're listening to WSKB 89.5 FM, radio for the Westfield Masses, WCPC, cable channel 15. Thank you for everyone for joining us for our 10-year anniversary edition. Pete Coles, the city's media system specialist, former Mayor Dan Knapik, former Senator Mike Knapik. Thank you so much for joining us. We'll see you next week.
Still having fun, and you're still the one.